ਨਾ ਮੈਂ ਮੋਮਿਨ ਵਿੱਚ ਮਸੀਤਾਂ, ਨਾ ਮੈਂ ਵਿੱਚ ਕੁਫਰ ਦੀਆਂ ਰੀਤਾਂ, ਨਾ ਮੈਂ ਪਾਕਾਂ ਵਿੱਚ ਪਲੀਤਾਂ, ਨਾ ਮੈਂ ਮੂਸਾ ਨਾ ਫਰਿਆਉਣ, ਕੀ ਜਾਣਾ ਹੈ ਉਹ ਕੌਣ ਕਿ ਬੁੱਲਾ, ਕੀ ਜਾਣਾ ਮੈਂ ਕੌਣ, ਨਾ ਮੈਂ ਅਰਬੀ ਨਾ ਲਾਹੌਰੀ, ਨਾ ਮੈਂ ਹਿੰਦੀ ਸ਼ਹਿਰ ਨਗੌਰੀ, ਨਾ ਹਿੰਦੂ ਨਾ ਤੁਰਕ ਪਿਸ਼ੌਰੀ, ਨਾ ਮੈਂ ਰਹਿੰਦਾ ਵਿੱਚ ਨਿਦੌਣ, ਕੀ ਜਾਣਾ ਹੈ ਉਹ ਕੌਣ ਕਿ ਬੁੱਲਾ, ਕੀ ਜਾਣਾ ਮੈਂ ਕੌਣ, ਅਵਲ ਆਹਰ ਆਪ ਨੂੰ ਜਾਣਾ, ਦੂਜਾ ਨਾ ਕੋਈ ਹੋਰ ਪਛਾਣਾ, ਮੈਥੋਂ ਨਾ ਕੋਈ ਹੋਰ ਸਿਆਣਾ, ਬੁੱਲਾ ਸ਼ੌ ਖੜਾ ਹੈ ਕੌਣ, ਕੀ ਜਾਣਾ ਹੈ ਉਹ ਕੌਣ ਕਿ ਬੁੱਲਾ, ਕੀ ਜਾਣਾ ਮੈਂ ਕੌਣ, ਹੂ ਐਮ ਆਏ, ਕੀ ਜਾਣਾ ਮੈਂ ਕੌਣ, ਆਈ ਆਲਵੇਜ਼ ਵੰਡਰਡ ਹੂ ਐਮ ਆਏ, ਐਂਡ ਵਨ ਡੇ ਆਈ ਆਸਕਡ ਮਾਈ ਮਦਰ, ਮਾਂ ਹੂ ਐਮ ਆਏ, ਇਨ ਹਰ ਕੰਪਲੀਟ ਇਗਨੋਰੈਂਸ ਸ਼ੀ ਰਿਪਲਾਈਡ, ਯੂ ਆਰ ਮਾਈ ਸਨ, ਅ ਗੁੱਡ ਹਿਊਮਨ ਬੀਂਗ, ਬਟ ਯੂ ਨੋ ਵਟ, ਯੂ ਵਰ ਨੋਟ ਬੋਰਨ ਹਿਊਮਨ, ਯੂ ਵਰ ਬੋਰਨ ਲਾਈਕ ਅ ਮੰਕੀ ਵਿਦ ਅ ਟੇਲ, ਐਂਡ ਦੈਨ ਵੀ ਹੈਡ ਟੂ ਗੋ ਥਰੂ ਅ ਵੈਰੀ ਕੰਪਲੀਕੇਟਿਡ ਸਰਜੀਕਲ ਪ੍ਰੋਸੀਜਰ ਟੂ ਰਿਮੂਵ ਯੂਅਰ ਟੇਲ ਐਂਡ ਮੇਕ ਯੂ ਲੁੱਕ ਸਮ ਵਟ ਲਾਈਕ ਅ ਹਿਊਮਨ, ਬਟ ਵੀ ਕੁਡ ਨੋਟ ਚੇਂਜ ਯੋਰ ਹੈਬਿਟਸ, ਯੂ ਸਟਿਲ ਕੀਪ ਜੰਪਿੰਗ ਫਰੋਮ ਵਨ ਪਲੇਸ ਟੂ ਅਨਦਰ. Few years later, I had another question about myself, and this time I had already burnt my fingers or tail in this case with my mother, so I did not go to my mother, I went to my father and I asked him, why did you name me Vikramjit? And like all dads are, he looked at me and then his response was, I love the way Samrat Vikramaditya used to rule. So I was quite satisfied, I was happy. Samrat Vikramaditya is such a big name in India. Even our Indian calendar, the Vikrami Samvat is named after him. So he must have done something good. At that time, I didn't realize, but a little later, I started thinking and my curiosity took a leap. So I started studying about Samrat Vikramaditya. Found out that this is the same guy after whom those stories of Vikram Betal were made. So that's where I figured out why I was always called Betal in school. Baharhal, he is said to be the king of Ujjain near Bhopal, Madhya Pradesh. Another account establishes him as the king of Pataliputra in Patna. So there were so many multiple accounts and dates. It was kind of confusing to find the correct information. However, that entire process left me with several intellectual rewards. For example, I read about this legendary poet Kalidas. Kalidas wrote a treatise known as Jyotirvidabharna, where he mentions about the 9 jewels or the 9 gems or the Navratans of Samrat Vikramaditya. We have Navratans of Akbar also, we have Navratans of many other kings. So Navratan became a very popular thing, and this is the very first instance that where we get the mention of Navratans. One of these Navratans is Kalidas himself. Kalidas wrote some beautiful plays like Malvika Agni Mitra, Vikram Urvashi and the Shakuntala, very first play to be translated to English, very first Sanskrit play to be translated to English. In fact, this play Shakuntala became inspiration for many other European writers. Kalidas also wrote epics like Raghuvansh, Kumar Sambhav. In fact, Meghdoot, written by Kalidas, created a new genre of poetry. I also found out about Amar Sinha. Amar Sinha, who wrote Amarkosh, the very first and by far the largest Sanskrit thesaurus. This book was divided into 3 parts. Part 1 was Swargadi Khand, which talks about all the celestial bodies, God, heaven. Part 2 is Bhuadi Khand, which talks about earth, animal, human being, plant and everything material. The third part, which is the Samanya Adi Khand, it talks about common words, grammar, miscellaneous stuff. This is that one book which got translated to Chinese, Pali and all other contemporary languages. Moving ahead, I found out these 2 guys and these 2 jewels of Samrat Vikramaditya got me thinking how less I know about myself and about my country. These were Varahamihir and Vararuchi. These people changed the way we look at technology, science, education. Vararuchi, for example, is also mentioned as Katyayan in many records. And Katyayan wrote few books. One of them is Vartika, which is actually an elaboration on Panini's grammar. And along with Vartika and Ashtadhyayi of Panini, the Mahabhashya of Patanjali, the Sanskrit grammar is considered to be complete. So these are the three things that were being taught in all our ancient schools, gurukuls, ashrams, since beginning, since we defined grammar. And without Vararuchi's work, this entire study of Sanskrit was considered incomplete. Vararuchi also wrote Sulabhsutras. These sutras, the nine texts, were actually elaboration on many geometric shapes. He extended the treatment of a theorem given by Bodhyayan in some 800 BC. Three or four centuries later, after Bodhyayan, another man from Samos, Greece, talked about the same theorem, and today we know that theorem by his name as Pythagoras theorem. He also wrote Ubhe Abhisarika, which is a satirical monologue and first complete play of Sanskrit. You guys know about that story of crocodile and monkey, where crocodile's wife says that, okay, why don't you bring me the heart of monkey, and I've heard that that heart is very tender, so I want to taste the heart of monkey. And crocodile tricks monkey, brings him, and halfway through, when they're crossing the river, crocodile tells that this is not why I'm taking you. My core objective is something else. My wife wants to taste your heart. And that's when monkey says, oh, you should have told me earlier. I left my heart at the tree. Let's go back and pick my heart. So they went back. This is actually a frame story. There's a story within a story. And this is from Panchatantra. Panchatantra is that amazing book which was written to teach management lessons. In book 4, this story is titled On Losing What You Have Gained. And the story that runs within this frame story is of Vararuchi. Vararuchi and King Nand. So what happens is, Vararuchi figures out that his wife is upset or unhappy with him. So he tries to please her, and the wife says, if you want to please me, shave your head, prostrate before me, and then maybe I'll forgive you, I'll be pleased. And this news reaches the queen, wife of King Nand. So she says, okay, let me also try whether my husband would do that or not for me. So what she does, she says, okay, I'll not ask him to shave his head. I want to go a little more creative, something different. What do I do? What do I do? Okay. King Nand, this is what you need to do. Bow down, act like a horse, neigh like a horse, and I'll ride you. If you do that, I'll be happy. Next day, when King Nand saw that Vararuchi is there in the court with shaved head, he asked him, what happened to you? Now Vararuchi, the clever guy, he said, oh my king, is there anything that a lady asks and the man denies? He would even shave his head or neigh like a horse. Now that story was told by monkey to the crocodile, and he said that you are acting like Vararuchi and King Nand as a slave of your wife, but your chatter gave it away. And the moral of the story is, silence is golden. Sometimes you need to keep quiet. He also wrote Chandravakyas. These are the series of texts, they've got so many numbers in there, which gives us the accurate position of moon around Earth's orbit. And these Chandravakyas were later used to create Vakya Panchang. This comes from the Kerala tradition. Vararuchi is mentioned in so many different traditions. Moving ahead, I started reading about Varahamihir. It won't be wrong if I say I fell in love with this guy. We always credit Aryabhatta for so many things. However, Aryabhatta's work was lost with time. It was Varahamihir who actually recreated that work. Some say that he was contemporary of Aryabhatta, some say he came a century later. But it is only in the work of Varahamihir where Aryabhatta's work survived. And he did not just copy it, he corrected it. He added precision to most of the calculations. And not just with Aryabhatta, he picked up work from all ancient engineers, scientists, researchers. He copied their work, he researched them, he made them more accurate and better. There is a debate going on whether Varahamihir was in the court of Samrat Chandragupta Vikramaditya or Samrat Yashodharman Vikramaditya, who ruled a portion of the former's territory a century later. Or we're not going into the debate of who his monarch was and just focusing on the kind of work that he has done, one may jump off his or her seat. He wrote Panch Siddhantika, the five Siddhant, five treaties. These five treaties were basically the work that was already existing, but he improved them, corrected sign tables. For example, if I talk about Surya Siddhant, he said that if you plant a long pole and on a particular day, at a particular time, the shadow casted from that pole, you measure the shadow, you know the height of the pole, you know the exact time, you can calculate distance between earth and sun. Divide that by 108, you get the diameter of sun. You get distance between earth and moon. You can calculate circumference of moon, of sun, of earth. He gave all those formula just by one single stick and its shadow. He wrote Romka Siddhant. He wrote Polish Siddhant, the doctrine of Pauls, the doctrine of Rome. What is most important of his works, I personally feel, is Bhrat Samhita. In Bhrat Samhita, he is the first one to mention something called Vastu Purush, which later became the basis of Vastu Shastra. This mythical creature is aligned with the magnetic rays of earth. So everything from town planning to designing a house to decorating a room is calculated from here. In Bhrat Samhita, he also mentions magic square. I don't know how many of you know magic square. Magic square is a series or a grid of numbers where we have equal number of rows and equal number of columns, and the sum from each row and each column as well as diagonally has to be same. He is the first one to create a 4x4 magic grid, and his creativity took a leap, because what he did, he picked up 16 different ingredients, placed them in the grid, added quantities to it, and if anything goes wrong, the sum total will differ. You will know that there is something missing, so you'll correct it. The moment you mix these quantities in perfect proportion, as he has mentioned, you get a perfume. Wo bhi bina gas wala. And his book also mentions how to check weather, observe weather. So his perfume was not just some liquid that you put when you don't take bath. This perfume was also good for your health, because what kind of weather there is, what kind of body you have, he suggested accordingly. In Bhrat Samhita, he wrote on astrology, rainfall, planetary motion, gems, clouds, crop growth. He even gave away a way to predict earthquakes, though that was very initial stage, and even today we are working on those things. Many more scientists and researchers have told that what he wrote may have some value, but we still need to research further. He said that there is some force deep inside earth that pulls everything towards it. He called it Gurutvakarshan. 1,000 years later, another man known Sir Isaac Newton gave a new name, gravity. He is the first one to give the concept of what we later started calling Pascal's triangle. He also gave us the concept of reflection and diffraction. He started explaining those phenomena in his book. There was a point when I decided that there is no point sitting in my office working on computer 9 to 5. So I stepped out. I started learning more. I figured out that there is so much that has not been discovered. I started reading. I started exploring monuments. I started exploring heritage. And today, when I go to schools and colleges, I conduct my workshops, I start with one question. I ask my audience, do you know your name? Yes, of course you know. Do you know the meaning of your name? Maybe yes. But did you even try to explore why you were given that name? What is the story behind it? Or are there more stories associated with it? How deep can we go? Vedic rishis have always told us there is a universe inside us. It's good to explore the universe. How about we start with the universe deep inside us, and what good way to start with our own name. Thank you. Dhanyavaad. This is me, Vikramjit Singh Rooprai.